On the 24th of July, AMD released a security bulletin about a cross-process information leak. Potential impact, information disclosure, severity medium. It sounds pretty harmless, but actually, it's a pretty crazy CPU vulnerability. And of course, I was excited to make a video about this vulnerability, but after talking to Tavis Ormandy, the researcher who found this vulnerability and called it ZenBleed, I realized that the discovery process itself is amazing, and I decided I want to make a two-part video. Part one, the discovery process, and part two, looking at ZenBleed specifically. So if you are interested in that, consider to subscribe. Anyway, in this first video, we are now going to learn about how this vulnerability was discovered, basically learn about the research process. We are going to see pure creativity and ingenuity and technical skill and experience, which combined resulted in the discovery of ZenBleed. At the end of this video, once you understand the novel approach, how this vulnerability was discovered, you will also understand that because of this new approach, this could mark the start of a new era of CPU vulnerabilities. And you have a chance to follow the story right from the start. This video is sponsored by Google, more on that later. Remember my Minecraft hacking server project? Well, look at the CPU installed on the server. It's an AMD Ryzen 5 3600, which is a Zen 2 CPU, which should be vulnerable. As you can see on the server, there are several Java processes running, which are the Minecraft server, and they are running as the user called user. I have a second shell here acting as the attacker with the user hacker. So we have two different users active on the same machine. And the hacker user should not be able to read the data from the Minecraft server. That's a security boundary. One user cannot access the data from another user. But when I run the ZenBleed proof of concept program, look at that output. Spawning 12 threads running on different CPU cores, and suddenly we see text related to Minecraft. Somehow the hacker user got access to data of the Minecraft server process, which should not be possible. Now, maybe this doesn't seem too critical to you. I mean, the attacker is already on the same machine, so why would this vulnerability be a big deal? Well, think about big data centers and servers you can rent, like compute instances from Google Cloud.
Because of cloud computing, multiple users can share the same resources. So making sure that it's safe to share a CPU between multiple untrusted users is very important.
And because it's this important for Google, they actually created a new CPU security research team, and Tavis Ormandy is part of it.
So after 10 years of being on Project Zero, Eduardo told me about this new team for studying hardware security at Google. And well, you know, that's pretty exciting. So I thought, yeah, why not? Let's do it.
In case you don't know, Tavis Ormandy is a very well-known and skilled security researcher with a huge track record. Let me just quote here from Wikipedia. Ormandy is credited with discovering severe vulnerabilities in libtiff, Sophos antivirus software, Microsoft Windows, FireEye products, glibc. And do you remember the CloudBleed vulnerability? A buffer overflow in Cloudflare leaking HTTP request data from other people. Yeah, Tavis is incredible. But the reason why I wanted to mention this is because you might notice a pattern here. Yes, he found vulnerabilities in tons of different software. So what's the pattern? Well, it's all software. So how does a software guy find a hardware vulnerability?
I feel like as a software security guy, I feel like I'm bringing a fresh set of eyes onto this that maybe people who are very focused on CPU security haven't noticed before, because the people who work on this stuff are more EE focused. So yeah, I feel like I'm bringing in a new perspective.
And this perspective he's talking about is his experience with fuzzing. He has a lot of experience fuzzing various software.
We were experimenting with new ways of fuzzing CPUs. Basically, we wanted to apply the same kind of fuzzing methodology we use for software, we wanted to apply that to hardware. If you're trying to fuzz software, the best performing fuzzers always use feedback. They get feedback from the software they're being fuzzed, and that's usually in the form of code coverage. So when you discover a new interesting piece of code, the fuzzer knows about it and knows to keep testing this area or not to throw away this test case or use it as an input for future fuzzing.
So let's talk about this. To implement a modern fuzzer, you need basically three components. First, you need something to generate random input. By the way, I have created a very detailed series about fuzzing the sudo program to rediscover the sudoedit vulnerability. So let me use sudo as an example to explain those components. For sudo, we want to generate random program arguments. So we want valid arguments like minus h, minus v, or minus s, but also random strings like aaa backslash or abcd 1234, pretty simple. Then you need a component to detect if the generated input leads to a vulnerability. For sudo, being a C program, we probably are looking for seg faults, segmentation faults, so the program crashes. These crashes are generally a good indication that we found an exploitable bug, and crashes are easy to detect. And lastly, we want coverage information. We were using AFL to fuzz sudo, and AFL basically inserts additional code into sudo code, which is used to collect information about the executed functions. And the trick is now, this coverage information can be used as feedback to the input generator to mutate the input, trying to keep increasing the coverage. We want to reach as many functions in sudo as possible. And yeah, for fuzzing software, these three components make sense. But how do you implement these components for fuzzing CPUs? I mean, generating input is pretty straightforward. You just need to generate random assembly instructions. But the other two components, detecting whether something interesting happened, and the coverage information, I have no idea how you could implement that for CPUs. And that is where me and Tavis differ. He, of course, has a brilliant idea.
There is no coverage in CPUs, so when you're fuzzing them, basically what people mostly do is just generate a random stream of bytes, execute it, and then see if anything interesting happened. But that's super hard to do. And so what we wanted to do was, instead of code coverage, we would use performance counters so that when some interesting event happened, fuzzer would monitor that, notice that something interesting, and then count that as some interesting sample that needs to be integrated into the set of samples that we're fuzzing.
Okay, so Tavis said that they are using performance counters to measure coverage. But I didn't understand that right away. I imagined a performance counter to be basically an instruction that tells you how much time or how many cycles have passed, counting how many instructions the CPU executed or so. Well, that is kind of true, but performance counters are so much more.
So what we do is we measure the performance counters of the entire system before and after execution. And then there are performance counters for all kinds of interesting architecture state. If you look through the list of documented performance counters, there are things like whether any microcode assists were used, whether there was any stalls caused for any reason. And so after that happens, we can say whether the CPU was doing something interesting while executing this. And we don't know what it was, but it doesn't matter. The point was that something interesting happened.
Okay. Yeah. In my mind, the performance counter, I only had like cycles counter in my mind, but I didn't realize that there are performance counter for all like kinds of other metrics.
Oh, there's tens of thousands of them, and most of them are undocumented. Some of them are documented, and they're so interesting to read through because some of them use terms that I'm just not familiar with.
Oh wow, there are so many.
There was one front end retired latency greater than or equals to 2, bubbles greater than or equal to 3, and it turns out that this one was like turned out to be a good one. I don't know what that means. I just know that there were these magic numbers, and I want the numbers to go higher.
Performance counters or hardware counters are a set of special purpose registers built into modern microprocessors to store the counts of hardware related activities within the computer system. Advanced users often rely on those counters to conduct low level performance analysis or tuning. Here's a list of documented performance counters for Intel CPUs, and there you can find metrics of how many CPU cycles were executed, like I assumed, but I also imagined there to be a single metric for that. But look at this. You have the amount of clock cycles when the thread is unhalted and clock cycles when at least one thread is unhalted. So even for something simple like counting clock cycles, there are many variations. And so there are lots of different counters like that. Counting how many transitions between ring 1, 2 or 3 to ring 0 happened. Just scroll through the list, it's insane. Here is also the bubble one that Tavis mentioned, which counts the retired instructions that are fetched after an interval where the front end had at least 3 bubble slots for a period of 2 cycles which was not interrupted by a back end stall. Like Tavis, I have also no clue what that means. But this is the secret to the fuzzer. This is his coverage information. While you cannot instrument and trace the hardware internals of the CPU, the performance counters tell you basically what happened. There's a counter that goes up when a branch was mispredicted by the speculative execution, or counters that count the amount of cache misses. So these performance counters can tell you whether a certain CPU feature was used. Very similar to how AFL instruments a binary to tell you whether a certain function got executed. What a clever idea. And when I understood that, I immediately realized something. Yeah, interesting. That means even your, because there are so many and you don't know which ones might be very interesting ones, the fuzzer performance could greatly be impacted by which of these performance counters you decide to use for the fuzzer.
Yeah, so a lot of the work was figuring out which counters are useless and finding out which ones seem to, just as a heuristic, just seem to make more interesting code.
So coming back to the fuzzer components, now we understand two of them. We can generate random instructions and we have feedback. When we generate instructions and observe that they make certain performance counters go up, our instruction generator can favor those generated instructions and intelligently evolve and mutate those inputs. This generic algorithm then automatically creates more and more interesting instruction sequences, making more interesting performance counters go up. Very cool. Now, the only last puzzle piece missing is, how do we even detect a CPU bug? In C programs, we often look for segfaults or crashes. In Java programs, we maybe look for exceptions. But how can we detect when something interesting in a CPU happens? To figure that out, we could look at known CPU vulnerabilities and see how they worked. What do they have in common? Are there patterns that we can test for? And it turns out they all have something in common. Be it Foreshadow, Riddle, Meltdown, Spectre, Red Bleed, all of them are side channel or covert channel attacks. A while ago, I actually made a video about Riddle, a CPU vulnerability in Intel CPUs. And that video kind of complements this video here, because in that video, I explain in a bit more details how these side channel leaks work. And I also explain speculative execution. And if you don't understand either, please check out that video. But basically, in all those known CPU vulnerabilities, you always have these instructions to trigger the vulnerability. They generally involve speculative execution that loads something in a cache. And then afterwards, you measure cache access timings, which means if we are fuzzing this part, we use the same cache measurement to detect a leak. At least almost, just a small problem. If we measure a short cache access time, how do we know it's a leak and not just the code having loaded the cache totally legit before? Well, Tevis had a second brilliant idea.
For fuzzing a software, a crash is easy to recognize. It's a signal you catch and then you can act on it. But like with a CPU bug that maybe leaks like just a bit, like how do you even realize that a bit is leaked?
Oh yeah, so this is a really interesting problem. We came up with a new solution to this and we called it Oracle serialization. So what you do is you generate a fuzz sample and then you transform that by adding serialization instructions between every single instruction. What serialization instructions do is reset the internal state, the internal instruction level parallelism. And that's things like, the out of order execution and things like that. So then you have two samples. You have one sample that will just run and then you record the state before and after. And then you have this serialized oracle where you, which should produce exactly the same output, but it has, but it doesn't use any instruction level parallelism. So you basically have this serial sample. The idea is that the output should be identical, but if it isn't, then you know that one of these really complex subsystems went wrong somewhere. And then that's how you identify that there was an error.
That is so clever. The light just turned on in my mind. Because I was wondering if you instrument, with AFL or so, like a binary, then you insert instructions to gather the coverage and so forth. And so I was wondering, okay, if you now start like inserting coverage, even just a performance counter to like store that away somewhere, that already like messes with everything. But that is so clever to basically use, if I understand correctly, instructions in between that kind of make sure that everything is really serially executed, like force these instructions to really like slowly execute, like basically make sure no optimization, don't make anything fancy with those instructions, and compare that to just the clean result and see if something came out. Wow, that makes so much sense. It's so logical now that you say it.
Well, yeah. a lot of the bugs that people are finding are in speculation, and this bug included. And some of these serializing instructions are speculation boundaries, like LFENs. After every single instruction, we reset a speculation as well. So we know for sure no speculation can possibly be happening because every instruction is followed by a boundary.
Oh, that's so clever. That makes so much sense. I love it when solutions seem so obvious after you hear them, but I know I would have not thought of that.
And with that, we have the final component for the CPU fuzzer. We can now generate random instructions, use performance counters as coverage information, and detect leaks by comparing the result of the test case with the execution of an oracle, which uses additional instructions to basically disable all kinds of fancy CPU features. Awesome. Now we understand how Tevez and the team were able to fuzz CPUs. And with that, let's run the fuzzer and learn about the moment that Tevez found the issue. Let's talk about ZenBleed.
Tell me about the moment when you saw that sample, or what went through your mind. And did you also have false positives? How did you identify that this is actually in this case an issue?
Yeah, so it's still very new in the development. And as the way that we were developing it was we were getting it to run. And then usually after a few days or a few hours, it would find a sample that didn't work correctly. And usually this was a bug on our end. It was it's a sequence of instructions that we weren't transforming into a serialized form correctly, or we were not handling some side effect that we didn't expect. Every time we find an error, we would just fix it and then start it again. And so this time, the results just didn't make any sense, and we just couldn't figure it out. The state seemed to be coming from somewhere else on the machine that we just couldn't control, and we couldn't explain where it came from. And then so it took a while to minimize it and figure out exactly what was going on. And then as soon as we saw it, we realized this is state from the other core. So that's a bug. That can't happen.
Okay, but this was this typical, process when you start fuzzing a new target. You go into this iteration loop where you start, instrumenting, and then you realize, oh, you misinstrumented it and it's crashing because of your instrumentation or something and not actually a bug and so forth. So you were still in this development process, and so you stumbled over a behavior that you maybe even assumed, that's probably just, again, a mistake on our side. You were not even expecting necessarily to find something.
Yeah, I mean, this had happened so many times. I mean, we were a few weeks into development, and every day I had a few crashes that I had to go through, figure out what went wrong, and and then fix the serialization. I had no reason to think this wasn't another case of exactly the same problem. And this time it was.
It took them a while to minimize what they found and identify which instructions triggered the state difference, but eventually they came up with this. They discovered ZenBleed. I mentioned it in the beginning. At first, I just wanted to make a video about the ZenBleed vulnerability and explain this assembly snippet to you. What is happening here and what exactly is this bug? But when I was talking to Tevez, I realized to me the story of how it was discovered, the brilliant fuzzing ideas. This was as interesting to me as the bug itself. Don't get me wrong, the ZenBleed vulnerability is very different to most of the other CPU bugs that were found before. ZenBleed deserves another dedicated video to dive deeper into it. But I really wanted to spend time on this fuzzing topic because it explains how the bug was found. And this is the actual hacking part. This is the creative problem solving that I love about hacking. And I hope you can now appreciate the ingenuity and brilliance of this fuzzing method behind this vulnerability as well. But of course, I don't want to ignore the result. So subscribe, because in the next video, we will finally look at the actual ZenBleed vulnerability. But if you cannot wait, I also link the original write-up by Tevez below. Also, thank you Google for sponsoring this video. I always wanted to be part of a big zero-day disclosure, making a video right at the release, and this time it almost worked out. Google approached me before the public release, so I could prepare this video, and I was on vacation, sitting on a roller coaster, unable to make the video in time. But it doesn't matter in the end, because I still think this video is very valuable. So thank you Google for making this happen, and especially thank you Tevez for being so open to share your experience with all of us. I really enjoyed learning about this from you.